Okay, so the first thing I want to touch on real briefly, and it's probably one of the more important things for today, has to do with protection of young trees. And we've been talking for the past several years, really, about young tree care and why it's so important to protect young trees, just simply because as we're taking out trees because of HOB, we've got to be able to replant and grow new trees to provide some continuity for our citrus production. And I think everybody's aware, of course, the foundation of our young tree programs are the use of the soil-applied neonicotinoid insecticides. We're talking about Admire Pro, Platinum, and Belay. And those are the three main products that we have for providing protection of those young trees from becoming infected with HOB. And the reason behind that has to do with the fact that some of the studies we've done looking at psyllid feeding behavior, I know everybody's seen this before, we've shown that when you make these applications of these soil-applied neonicotinoids to that root system, it's taken up by the plant, it goes systemic. When the psyllids begin to feed on those plants, they quit feeding long before they reach the phloem. And that's what's required for the psyllid to actually put or inoculate the plant, put that bacteria into the plant to cause the disease HOB. And what these data right here, or the graphs right here show, is that quite simply this is on the far left. That's the repertoire of feeding behaviors that a psyllid would do on an untreated citrus plant. And if you look over here to the right, this is, for example, is the imidacloprid. And these phloem behaviors that are shown right here, phloem salivation and phloem ingestion, occur on an untreated plant, but they don't occur on the imidacloprid-treated plant, for example. And the same holds true for clothianidin and thymethoxam. And so that's why these have been really the mainstay for our young tree protection program. And I think, this table, if you haven't gotten one in the past, there's a laminated sheet out front that has the example young tree programs, season-long young tree programs for psyllid control. And quite simply, because these soil-applied systemic neonicotinoids prevent the psyllids from feeding in the phloem and inoculating those plants with the pathogen, what we're able to do is go basically every 6 weeks with a soil-applied neonic, keeping those trees protected as much as possible from HOB infection. And what we've got here in the orange bars are just representing foliar sprays of different insecticides, well, different modes of action, because what's really going to be important is to make sure that you don't go constantly just soil-applied neonics one after another without breaking up the rotating modes of action, because if we were to get resistance development in the psyllid population, then we'd have a case where the psyllids would actually be able to feed and they wouldn't die, and ultimately we'd have all of our young trees becoming infected. We've done a pretty good job going for trees less than the resets and then trees 3 to 5 foot tall. We've been able to provide season-long protection with this type of approach with the products that we currently have labeled and the use rates that we have labeled. The problem we've run into, though, has to do with when we get to the 5 to 9 foot tall trees, these products can work as soil-applied systemics on the 5 to 9 foot tall trees. But you have to increase the use rate such that we can only do 2 applications of imidacloprid or Admire Pro, actually, and 1 application of Platinum. It used to only be 1 application of Admire Pro, but there was the 24C, you remember, that was passed a couple year and a half ago that actually doubled the rate of Admire Pro per acre. So now we can do 2 applications of that Admire Pro. But you can see it doesn't get us very far throughout the season of providing year-long protection from psyllid feeding. And, of all the foliar-applied insecticides we have, none of them come anywhere near, as far as we know, close enough to matching the protection that's provided by the soil-applied systemic insecticides. So that's why, we really are trying to maximize the use of the soil-applied neonicotinoids as much as possible in our young tree care program. So how much protection are we going to provide or benefit from the soil-applied neonics? And actually, this slide, I showed this exact same slide last year here at Citrus Institute. But just as a review here, and remind everybody that they're not going to provide 100% protection. We generally, based on some multi-year field trials we've done, we've shown that we can expect about 1% to 3% infection rate annually, depending on the conditions in the grove. That's if everything's done, almost under perfect conditions. Obviously, there's going to be some differences in the distribution of the product within the plant that can affect whether or not you get full, complete control or protection of the plant. But probably what's more important is what's happening around that block of young trees. And we're talking about the psyllid pressure in the surrounding areas. The lower the psyllid population in the surrounding areas, the greater the success is going to be in keeping that HLB spread low. So it's really, we've talked a lot in the past about this being a numbers game. So it really is. So this is where the foliar sprays in our mature growth programs really come in handy, because again, we're trying to keep the psyllid population in the surrounding area low, so we have less pressure on those young blocks of young trees, or maybe even solid, or the resets of trees within a mature growth. And again, Brandon and Paige will be talking next about chimas. And again, this is the situation where chimas also become really important. If you have a successful chima, you're part of a successful chima, that'll help in the success you have also in your young tree program, again, just by keeping the psyllid population low. So what are we seeing with this in the field? I've told you, you know, some of the examples of things in the past that we've done research-wise. So I've been out and talking to a lot of different growers around the state and trying to get a better understanding of how their programs are working out up to date. And we've seen a lot of variations in success of the young tree programs. From a lot of the growers I've talked to, for trees that are about the 3 to 4 years of age, where everything's going really well, we're seeing an average rate of about 10% HLB in the 3-year-old to 4-year-old tree class. One of the best examples that I've seen so far was as low as 8% in a 4-year-old block, or just turned 4-year-old block. And that was a situation where the psyllid population had been kept under control in the surrounding area, and they were on a season-long soil-applied neonicotinoid program. Conversely, there's also, I've seen some examples where the psyllid population in the area surrounding a young block had not been controlled, or they had maybe a neighbor that was not managing psyllids. And in those type situations, I say, you know, we've seen up to 80% HLB by year 4. And actually just last week I saw a situation that was about 3.5 years old block that was 100% infected. So there's a lot of variation around the state in what's happening, but the key is where there's a season-long program that's been put in place, and they're also managing the psyllids around that grove. 10 to 12% infection after 4 years is seems really manageable and a doable thing. The problem, okay, here's just one example, just a slide showing a grove I was in just a couple weeks ago. And here you can see these are 4-year-old trees. You can see a few back here in the back, you can see a couple of symptoms of HLB. But this is, you know, this grove had been on a season-long neonic program and only had about a little over 10% infection at 4 years of age. So it can be done. So what's happening, though, is we're seeing once we get, again, to those 5 to 9 foot tall trees, you know, somewhere in that 3 to 5 year range, depending on how fast they're being pushed, this is where most of our infection is starting to show up, where we're running out of those soil-applied neonicotinoids. And so we've talked a little bit in the past about a belay. You know, I'm gonna back up one slide here, if it'll let me. The thing that's missing in this is, you see, while we can use belay here on these non-bearing trees, once we get to the bearing age trees, we're not able to use belay. And that was because of the label, the belay 50WDG label did not permit application to bearing trees. Now, what we've been doing, Valent has worked with EPA and FDACS and the CRDF, and they've been pursuing a new label for the belay 2.13SC. That's a slightly different formulation of belay. But this, what's happened is just recently, well actually as of February 19th, there was a Section 18 emergency use label that was submitted by FDACS to EPA to allow application of belay 2.13SC to bearing trees. And so that was submitted back on February 19th. And what's going to happen is when that's approved, this is actually the Section 18 will permit 2 applications of belay, again the formulation 2.13SC, to bearing trees in the 5 to 9 foot tall size class. So that's going to take a situation like this where we are right now, where we only have basically 3 neonic applications in the 5 to 9 foot tall tree class, and it's actually going to change it up a little bit where we can actually insert 2 additional soil-applied neonics in that 5 to 9 foot tall tree range. So that gets us much closer to our goal of providing year-round protection in that larger tree size, or intermediate tree size, that's where we start to really see some of our issues with HLB popping up. So the status of that belay label. The belay 2.13SC Section 18 label should have been approved by EPA for use beginning April 1, and it has yet to get the final EPA approval. And right now, my understanding is that that label is just being held up in Washington for some signatures. I was told this morning by Dan Botsmith of VA that they felt that the label probably would be approved into this week or early next week. But in the meantime, the FDACS and Commissioner Putnam's office has indicated that later on today they expect that they're going to issue a crisis exemption today, April the 8th, that's going to take over while we're waiting on EPA to approve the Section 18 label. This crisis exemption is going to allow the application of belay to bearing trees in the 5 to 9 foot tall tree class, again, until that Section 18 has been approved and submitted and approved. So we're really just, we've been checking our email all day waiting to see when that's going to come through, and we've been told that it's a 99.9% certain thing it's going to happen at some point today. And so when it happens, I'm sure you'll be getting emails from agents and mutual and different groups that'll be sending out that information to make sure everybody's up to date on what's happening. Now, when that label does get approved, what it's going to do is going to give you a maximum of 24 fluid ounces per acre per growing season of belay 2.13 SC. So this provides two applications at the rate of a 12 fluid ounces per acre, again, to those trees 5 to 9 foot tall. And we're talking about soil drench applications only. We're not talking about anything about foliar applications. This is just, again, to provide, to help extend and increase the duration of protection for our Young Tree Soil Applied Systemic Program. A few more details. It's going to have a PHI of 1 day on that label. And there's going to be a minimum interval between applications of 4 months. And I'll show you how that might look here in a minute. And one other use restriction on that label is that for trees 5 to 9 foot in height, it's going to also have the clause, do not apply belay from November 1st through the end of the following bloom period. So it's kind of similar to what we saw with the Admire 24C label that doubled the rate. We'll see a very similar wording for the belay label as well. So, like I said, you know, we're just waiting on this label to be approved by the committee, or at least the crisis exemption to be declared by Commissioner Putnam's office this afternoon. Once that happens and you want to utilize this label, there's actually this, I found out something else since I put this together, but there's two things you've got to be in possession of. One is this Section 18 draft label. Right now it's a draft, it should be approved later on, but until EPA approves the Section 18, you'll also need to be in possession of the crisis declaration letter from Commissioner Putnam's office. And what's going to happen is as soon as all that has been formalized later on today, I think Dan Botts and some others have mentioned they're going to provide all that information out to the different distributors around the state. So when you go to purchase the Belay 2.13 SC, you should be able to also get at the same time that letter, that declaration letter, as well as the draft Section 18. And I'm sure you'll also probably, if you're on Citrus Mutual's mailing list or your county agent's mailing list, you'll also probably receive those as email attachments later on as well. So just make sure that you're going to be in possession of both of those two documents if you're going to use this label. So switching gears a little bit, I'm also going to talk about some of the work looking at kaolin for silica control. Talked a little bit about that last year in the Citrus Expo Citrus Institute presentation as well. And here's just a shot of some trees. I don't know if it shows up very well here, but you can see they kind of got the white coating on them from the kaolin clay, that surround product. And we've done a lot of work looking at it this year around the state and during the dry season. It's worked really well in terms of helping maintain the psyllid populations at low levels. Some of the things that keeps on coming up about kaolin has to do with compatibility with insecticides. And we've done some kind of brief cursory looks at kaolin with some of the contact insecticides. And that and some of the previous studies that have been done have shown that in terms of general contact insecticides, there's not been really any issue in terms of reducing residual. And we're talking about where the residues in these contact insecticides stay on the leaf and kill the insects once they come in contact with that residue on the leaf surface. There has been a lot of questions, though, is kaolin compatible with translaminar and systemic insecticides? We're talking about insecticides that need to move into the leaf surface to actually become effective. This would be things such as Movento is a really good example, Agromec, or foliar applications of things such as Admire and Actara. And I've talked a lot. I'm going to show you some information that Mike Edenfield from Bayer has provided But we've been talking about this and all, and really when I was talking to Mike just used the term surfactant-driven systemics. That would be things like the Movento and the products we have listed here, where you're using a surfactant to get that product into the leaf because you want it to go into the leaf to start providing activity when the insects feed. And so that's what we're really concerned about, is because with those type of insecticides, is the kaolin, while it's a kind of a negatively charged neutral particle, does it still act as a barrier for the insecticide getting into the leaf tissue? And that was the big question at hand. So as I mentioned, Mike has worked with some growers, and they did some trials in the state this last year, mainly looking here at Movento, and they applied Movento alone, tank mixed with Surround, and also following multiple applications of Surround, just trying to determine what effects it might have on the Movento application. Because again, Movento is one of those insecticides and miticides that we want to actually go into the plant, and it can then move from old leaves to new leaf growth systemically. So it's very unique in that respect. So what they did is they actually, using those different treatments, they then went out and actually measured the systemic movement of Movento into new leaf tissue. As a means of determining whether that Surround inhibited the absorption of Movento by the leaf surface. So they actually were going out, taking leaf samples and quantifying how much Movento was making it into the leaves, not only the old leaves, but also the new leaf growth as well. And so here's just an example of the results they found. And so moving from right to left, this would be here, for example, Movento applied by itself with no kaolin or Surround. And then you compare it with Movento tank mixed with Surround. Here's Movento followed by Movento. Surround four applications around the year followed by Movento, and then the last one was a Surround three times a year in a row plus Movento. And what you can see here is that basically where you did the Movento by itself, the residues were much higher, and they're actually greatly reduced where you're actually adding Surround in. So it appears this is 7 days after treatment, and so these are mature leaves. So it looks like what's happening is the kaolin was actually providing a barrier, preventing some of that Movento from actually getting into the leaf tissue. And then the real test comes about 23 days later. They were sampling the new flush, the new leaf growth that was coming out on the trees. And what they showed here, the highest numbers of where the Movento was by itself, that new leaf growth had the highest residues of the Movento active ingredient compared to the different tank mixes or Surround followed by Movento. And so I'm not going to get all the details there, but just the conclusions that they came up with was that tank mixing Surround at 20 pounds per acre with Movento reduced the residues, the spirotetramat, the active ingredient residue, 69% 7 days after treatment. And systemic Movento metabolites on the new flush were reduced 23% 23 days after treatment. They also found that tank mixing Surround at 37 pounds per acre with Movento reduced the spirotetramat residues 59% 7 days after treatment. And systemic Movento metabolites on the new flush were reduced 45% 23 days after treatment. And then Movento applied 1 day after Surround reduced the residues 54%. And also the systemic Movento metabolites on the new flush were reduced 45% 23 days after treatment. So I said all that to say, really the take-home message from this, when you're working with a product like Movento that you want to spray on the leaves and have it get all absorbed by the leaf and move systemically in the plant, the recommendation is not to tank mix that Movento with Surround because it really is inhibiting some of the uptake of that insecticide by the plant. If we're talking about, again, back to a contact insecticide, you know, organophosphates, pyrethroids, things that stay on the surface of the plant, it shouldn't be an issue. But these types of products that we need to get absorbed by the plant, I need to be aware that the most recent stuff that's been done thanks to Bayer is showing that it is actually inhibiting the uptake of these systemic insecticides, the foliar applied systemics. And so I know they've got some additional work going on that you'll hear more about later on as well. So I'm going to wrap up real briefly here, talking just a little update on four new products that have hit the market in the past year. Closer, SC, this is sulfoxaflor, it's a Dow product. XRL and Veramark, these are Cyazypyr, DuPont products, and also a new one, Apta, Tolfenpyrad, which is an Ichino product. And so I'll just provide you just a little bit of a background, not going into too much detail on these products, but these are fairly recent registrations, the newest products we have out there. Closer, this is a Group 4C insecticide, If you know, group 4A insecticides are the neonics, the imidacloprid, thimethoxam, clothianidin. So far, based on the work that's been done, we've not seen any cross resistance between the group 4C and the group 4A insecticides, which is a good thing. So while it's not necessarily a true whole other mode of action class, we're still not seeing the cross resistance between the 4As and 4Cs. Closer has a PHI of 1 day and an REI of 12 hours. Target pests include Asian citrusillids, scale insects, mealybugs, aphids, you know, any kind of sucking insect pest. Closer seems to do really well on. It does control both the adult and nymphal stages of the psyllid, so it is getting the major life stages we're trying to target. And it also, the work we've done so far has shown that it does have that ability to disrupt pathogen transmission because it does kill the psyllids fast enough before they're actually able to reach the phloem. And that we're talking about a foliar insecticide application. We don't know how long, how many weeks that's going to last, and that's some work that's ongoing. But right now, or at least we are seeing some of that initial feeding disruption by the product. And probably one of the things that most of y'all have probably utilized this year is the fact if you were doing bloom sprays, this is one product that is permitted to be applied during bloom. I'm not going to get all the details on the label, but it does have a lot of advisory statements about suggested ways to apply during bloom, such as at night. But it still can be applied even during the day if need be. But again, one application is permitted during the bloom period with closer, which hopefully we are through at this point. So just some data showing the efficacy with closer. Again, closer will be the green bar. I'm comparing it here to Volume Flexi. This is a Syngenta product, which is a combination of thimethoxam and chlorantraniliprole. And then the orange bar is the untreated. You see our pre-counts here 7 days after application. They're all zeros compared to the untreated. We're testing psyllid adults here. And you see here at 14 days, 21, 28. Here at 34 days, we start to see the numbers starting to increase. And by 49 days after treatment, we've got the psyllid adult numbers and the closer starting to increase. But there's still no difference between the closer and the Volume Flexi here 49 days out. Those were psyllid adult numbers. Here are psyllid nymph numbers. Again, it's pretty much the same story. You can see out here out to about 49 days, you know, the populations are gradually starting to increase, and then by 55 days, you can see the psyllid numbers in the closer are no different from the untreated. And again, these are plot studies, and in a lot of ways, we're also measuring not only efficacy, or, you know, the residual, but it's really telling us how long it takes for the psyllids to come back in. So, you know, it's going to take a little bit of time getting used to the product and seeing how long it's going to last under your field conditions. Probably the one thing that we're not seeing with closer is, you know, really good citrus leaf miner control. When closer is applied with oil, you can see here, we're just really not getting much in the way of leaf miner control. Again, that's a 4 ounce rate of closer plus a 435 oil. And as a side note, I know that one of the reps with Dow has been doing some work and they have seen probably some increased leaf miner activity when they've mixed it with certain nutritionals. I'm not very up to date on how that work is going, but you can probably talk to Alejandro or somebody from Dow and they can fill you in more on that. But that's some work that's ongoing, trying to find a way to improve the leaf miner control with that product. Yeah, another product is Exorel. This is DuPont's product, Cyazypyr. This is a group 28 insecticide. This is the only other insecticide with the same group designation is Volume Flexi. And again, as I mentioned, you know, Volume Flexi from Syngenta is a tank mix of thimethoxam and chlorantraniliprole. And so that chlorantraniliprole is similar to the cyantraniliprole that's found in the Exorel. Exorel, this is a foliar insecticide application. It has a 1 day PHI, a 12 hour REI. The target pests are leaf miner and psyllid, and it does control both the psyllid adult and nymphal stages. And you can see here just some data. Okay, again, we're comparing Exorel with and without oil to, again, Volume Flexi. And you can see out here, all the way out to 34 days, we're looking pretty good. There's no differences here between the treatments compared to the untreated control. And again, all the way out to 50 days, it's comparable to the Volume Flexi. Those are psyllid adults. For psyllid nymphs, pretty similar, but once you get out here to about 55 days, you can see that the Exorel without oil, the control broke a lot sooner. So it does appear, you know, Exorel is a translaminar product, so you do want to get this product into the leaf tissue, and so that oil probably helps get a little more of that residue into the leaf, increasing the duration of control. And then the same thing held true with leaf miner control. It looked really good, but the only place where we saw breaks was when we did the X-Rail without the oil. Again, this is 1% oil that we combined with it right here that's looking very good, but the treatments without the oil didn't perform quite as well on leaf miner. So I think the take-home message is if you're going to use X-Rail, you want to at least try to put a 1% oil or other penetrating surfactant with that to get it into the leaf tissue. The other product from DuPont's Veramark, it's Cyazypyr, the same mode of action, all the same target pests. The difference here, this is actually the soil-applied version of Cyazypyr, or X-Rail. And the one thing to mention about this is, we've talked a lot about our young tree program, and the reason you're not going to hear me talking a lot about Veramark is because it is very slow-acting, and it's not going to prevent pathogen transmission via feeding disruption like the soil-applied neonicotinoids do. And we've done a number of studies with this in the lab and greenhouses. And here's, for example, just some results looking at the mortality of psyllids. These are on containerized plants where we did soil drenches of Admire, Platinum, Belay, and Veramark. We drenched them at the rates shown here. We actually let them sit for 3 weeks to make sure we got maximum uptake of the product into the plant. Then we caged 20 psyllids onto each plant. And you can see here about 24 hours out after the psyllids were caged, this is 3 weeks after the plants had been treated, we had pretty much nearly 100% control or kill with the Admire, Platinum, and Belay. But you can see here the Veramark at 24 hours, we're at about 90% of them are still alive. 48 hours, it's about 60-70%. In 72 hours, it's dropped down to about 10-15% of them are still alive. It does eventually kill the psyllids, don't get me wrong. It's just it's a little bit slower acting. Now, one of the questions is, okay, well, maybe they're sick here and they're not feeding, and there has been a number of studies done using those feeding monitors again. These are independent studies both by DuPont and UF IFAS that have shown both the foliar and the soil applications of Veramark fail to prevent psyllid phloem feeding behaviors in the first 24 hours after exposure. So when they first land on a treated plant with the Veramark, they are going to be able to actually feed on the phloem and potentially transmit the pathogen before they die. And so that's the reason I've got here at the very last bullet point is that I don't think this really is something that we want to use as a replacement product for soil applications of imidacloprid, clothianidin, or thymethoxam. Because those products will help provide protection from transmission or from infection, whereas the Veramark, while it will kill the psyllids, those plants still stand a chance of becoming infected. So lastly, I'm going to move on to the last insecticide, APTA, tolfenpyrad. This is a group 21A insecticide. It's the same mode of action as Portal or Fenpyroxamate. Has a 14-day PHI, 12-hour REI. Target pests are Asian citrus psyllid. It's also got on the label rust mites and leaf miner. I've not tested the product yet for rust mites, and I'll show you some leaf miner data that's a little questionable, but I'll show you what I've got, but we did have good data on psyllids. Again, you can see here's APTA. I've also got Portal in here as a comparison and Volume Flexi. And you can see here for an adult psyllids, all the products were working about the same throughout the course of this trial on adult populations. For the nymphs, you can see the APTA was looking pretty good, but once we get out here to about 55 days, you can see it's starting to break, but I think that's to be expected that far out with any general insecticide. But the main thing here is we didn't see very good leaf miner control with APTA. So we come out here 21 days, here's APTA and Portal. The numbers, the percent leaf miner damage is pretty high. And you get here to 28 days, and I think it's 34 days. Actually, the numbers are significantly higher than the untreated controls in terms of leaf miner damage. So we weren't really seeing real leaf miner control with the product. Having said that, the APTA label states 24 fluid ounces per acre for leaf miner and rust mite control. The rates we're using here were 17 fluid ounces. So perhaps going at a higher rate, it might actually provide leaf miner control. I just don't have the data to support that right now.